What's poppin', everybody? In this video, I'm going to show you guys how you can create a Fred Again or Duskus style house track. We're talking 130 beats per minute, steady sounds, good vibes, summer vibes. Also, in the description, you can find a link to a free sample and presets pack for this track. And so, if you're interested in getting some of these sounds that are used in this track, then just click on the first link, fill out a little fan guide, and you can get it for free. And so, the track I'm going to show you is a track that I just released on Chill Planet. It's called Still Alive, and this is what it sounds like. I'm breathing, I'm still alive. Thanks to Chill Planet for releasing this. This is a little breakdown of this track. This track isn't even that big. My projects are often in the 200s. This track is sitting at around 113 tracks, so 112. The main bulk of this track was actually made in 5 hours on my laptop at my girlfriend's place, so it was a very nice experience just producing this. So we start off with an intro where we have only the vocal, first thing, with a bunch of processing. And by a bunch of processing, I mean a channel EQ. Opens up a little bit, a crush by Tri-Tick, very cool plugin. I'm highly recommending this. Delay designer. This is a hypercracked plugin that you guys probably don't know, even if you're using Logic, but check out these presets here. They are insane. I'm using this a lot in my newer productions now. Like this. All of this is this Delay Designer plugin. Can get a lot of great stuff out of this. A Valhalla Room, an Echo plugin, and an OTT just to make it stand out a little bit more. And so that's the vocal for the intro, paired together with a Labs piano, which is the soft piano that you all know probably by now. Again, a Delay Designer. Chorus, channel EQ, getting rid of the lows, which I think also opens up towards the end. Yes, it does. And then a crush at the end. That together with some forest ambience, because, you know, the chill day out in the sun, so to get that vibe in there. And then also this big reverb and then reverse thing. That's the whole intro. That's about it. I'm breathing, I'm still alive. So again, in the drop, the vocal, which is throughout the whole thing, just the leading thing. And it also just repeats. There's nothing crazy here. I'm breathing, I'm still alive. We have this like suck. I'm breathing and I'm still alive. Alive. Yeah, with a Logic stock tremolo, which is again just reverbed, reversed. We also have this thing with a rotor cabinet effect and the ensemble. It's like a question answer thing, right? So we have the vocal here and then the chords come in. Then here we get into like another section where we have on top of the clean vocal, just a down pitched vocal. Yeah, so that's basically for the vocals, and we kind of do the same thing for the second break, which is like a build up just. Got some like Delay Designer here, sparing preset, gives it that like metallic-y type of thing. Also very low on the dry signal, just wet basically, together with this. Second drop. And then there's this little thing before the drop, this type of deal. This is an LFO tool, and I'm automating the rate of the LFO tool to go from 128th to 1/4. We also have a direction mixer spread and a Valhalla room that does this thing, and didn't even keep that in. So it's hyper simple stuff, just an LFO tool. This is how you do this cool effect, you know. Let's get into the synths, because there's some cool stuff here. So as said, this is like the answer to the question that the vocal asks. I'm breathing, I'm still alive. I like these sounds a lot, and I think this is also maybe the coolest thing about the whole track. We got full strings, which is a sampler instrument, which can be found somewhere. I don't really remember where. Oh, here it is, full strings. So it's actually a garage band sound. As Fox Stevenson once said, shit sounds are underrated, and I definitely agree. We have this reverb curve here. Also, when you do this kind of stuff, never forget to automate the early late mix as well, because if you don't, then you will have a little bit of a tail at the end. So when you want the reverb to stop here and you just automate the mix, then it's gonna ring out a little bit. And if you then also automate the early late mix, then it's gonna be fine. Okay, then I also have this filter automation, so just a channel EQ high cut automation. So the sound without that one would sound like this. Quite terrible. Not even terrible, it's actually quite cool, I think. And then with the filter automation. And I love doing this. This takes time, but you get full control. And it's super cool. And it's very important. I've talked about this a bunch of times. It's do this kind of stuff. If you want to make like filter cortical, like wow, you know, you don't want to set a automatic kind of auto filter type of deal. No, you don't want that. You want to actually draw it in by hand. Why? Sometimes a 50 millisecond difference in the way in which the filter reacts can make like the difference between a phrase that's cohesive and a phrase that isn't. So draw this in by hand. It's very important. Yeah, and then, you know, just some stuff, some Pro MB, even twice OTT, and some EQing. I don't have to go into that. And also obviously a sidechain, this sidechain curve, which is on everything here, you know, a shaper box. We have another one, same automation data. So without the filter. So this is the ESE. Welcome, guys, to the ESE. Anyways, then we also have the same thing with a piano if I get rid of the filter. This thing. And then here in the second part of the first drop, we get like another layer, hooky brass, this is called. Yeah, and so this one I EQ'd a little bit differently to have more like high end before the filter. And so it just has a little bit more energy. Also, I think it's an octafier, so this is one of the things that comes with the second part of the first drop. Also, by the way, there are always like these chords here, and this is a pretty cool thing. You should probably check this out. What do you think? How did I do this? Oh my god, he's a sound design genius. No, he's not. It's a sine wave. And then you have a curve like this. You give this the precise amount of swing that it needs. So LFO tool. And then after that, a crush again. Also, the chords here are like pretty cool because they're only like three-part harmonies, but cool voicings. But in the second part, there is actually a sound that I'm pretty proud of. And I think it's this one. It might be this one. Yes, this one. So this is actually one of the things that I now did with an auto filter. And I actually think that this is a pretty cool technique. So you can maybe learn something from this video, because this, I just wanted to have like random squiggles in the back. So I put the chords into the piano roll, basically, and you get this. And you also see that the chords are like playing in an arpeggiated manner, and none of that is controlled. It's just the arpeggio MIDI transformer here with the correct amount of swing again, 67%. And then what's happening basically is we have an equalizer, we have a Pro MB, we have a chorus effect, and then, but this is the very important thing, we have an auto filter, which is basically transforming the input volume into a cutoff value and then outputting the signal again. So, and this is super cool, I think. Now, if you move around the threshold, which is currently minus 15, you'll get a totally different result. Same obviously also goes for the cutoff. Yeah. That's cool, isn't it? I'm also automating the cutoff so that it opens up towards the end. That's a really cool sound. So this is just an auto filter. Afterwards, we also have a tremolo that does, you know, the right left panning so that we have it on the sides and not like... I've also added more LFO sort of chord sounds here. Just the exact same technique as the one we had before. But one of them is also arpeggiated. So this is an Alchemy preset that just comes... Big Anthem Up, it's called, yeah. It's just an arpeggiated preset from Alchemy. So this is just, you know, looking for presets and copying the information that you made for one track over to another and just seeing what works, just trying it out, and some happy accidents happen, and that's how you make a track, kind of. I think that's the main gist. Also here, this vocal again, as said, I think with just some like delay designer, hysteresis, fracture, and then again also putting that through an LFO tool, and all of this kind of creates a nice ambience, you know. And that together with this kind of stuff. Creates a pretty cool ambience, I would say. That's for the chord sounds. Let's get into the bass right here, man. Let's go. So this is, again, very, very simple. We have two bass layers for the beginning of the drop. Bouncy bass line. Yeah, that's what I like. Also opens up a little bit. Okay, so first of all, we have a sub bass. Sounds like this. It's actually not a serum, not a just a sine wave type of deal. No, it's a retro synth. And this is a preset that I kind of, you know, I think it's from the Deep Square bass, kind of a derivative of that. I messed around with some settings and tweaked it until I liked it, and then saved it as Disclosure bass. And so I think this is cool. Also cool because you can just animate the cutoff and you get this very natural thing, you know. Yeah, I think it's dope. And then we have another one, another Disclosure bass, and here we have a crush again. And a crushed bass. Together, sounds pretty good. Again, very important, make sure that you automate some stuff to give it some movement, because if it's just sitting there, it's gonna be too boring. That's crazy, isn't it? What did I do here? Well, this is a delay designer with the sparing preset, which is this metallic feedback type of deal. And I'm automating both the sub bass and the sort of mid bass layer. Why? Because it also opens up like a lot of low wideness. And if you have ever listened to Duskus, he has many moments where the low end and like the kick, everything's completely off to the sides. It's just a cool thing, just a cool little effect. Yeah, a lot of inspiration for this track obviously also came from him. So shout out Duskus if you see this. We go into the second part and we add one more bass layer, a little bit more aggressive now. Oh, I love this sound though. That's a cool sound. Also cool because you can just open it up. And this is a serum this time. And this is what it sounds like without effects. Again, the crush adds this super nice. Yeah. Channel EQ to, you know, boost the mid here. And then B to tame it back down. This is what the preset looks like. This is a plug that I made for a song called Start Again. If you haven't heard this one, this is what it sounds like. Yeah, and so in this song, I have a bunch of really cool plug sounds, and one of them is this one, and I just tweaked it a little bit and put it in there. So this is a sub oscillator, which is a saw wave. We have a square wave and another saw wave. Both of these are doing +7. And so then when we go and add all these effects, especially the hyperdimension here adds a lot. So without, sounds like this. With, adds all of that great to the sides. Yeah, and then we have like an OTT compressor here within Serum. Also very cool. All right, so this is an aggressive thing, and then I'm opening it up with a macro, and also the delay wet towards the end gets automated, just like for the other bass layers, to again introduce this like side madness here. We have drums to talk about. Very simple stuff, not much going on. This is all the drums, so. This is the kick. DKP kick smacker just from Splice, and laid on top of that we get this thing. Very important, because otherwise the track sounds shit. Like seriously, if I mute this, that's no good. And then with, yeah, then we have some claps, a bunch of claps here. Let's just check those out. Yeah, and so this as one whole clap will also be in the description. So as said, if you want to get the samples, if you want to get the sounds, link is in the description, guys. Layering claps on top of each other is very nice, very forgiving. I'm also, in this case, not deciding to do something that I usually do, which is taking the claps, all of them, basically, and kind of moving them slightly ahead of the kick. I decided against that because that would sound like this. And I have this little garage percussion thing, which is like the main percussion thing. Some pan percussions here. This is all just sample selection, just finding good samples, and I was lucky that I did in like a very short amount of time. Very dirty head here. But the cool thing about this head is that I pitched it down a lot and I managed to fit it to the key of the track. So the key of the track is D minor, and so this is also... So if you listen closely... So this head here usually would have sounded like this. Crazy, right? It's kind of harsh. It kind of sounds shit, but no sooth, no nothing. It's a little, just leaving it a little bit unclean sometimes is a plus point, because when things are too perfect, you kind of don't trust them as much anymore, I feel like. So, yeah. Some more drum loops. These guys. Oh, really, just this one. Also nice and dirty, not high quality by any means. Yeah, we have an enveloper here as well. By the way, this is the one of the best transient shapers you will ever see, and it's a Logic stock plugin. It's crazy, dude. It really is. Sometimes they're a pain in the butt and they create like grainy artifacts, but this thing... That's crazy, isn't it? Yeah, I also have a kilohertz transient shaper after that, to be fair. To be fair, because I had to get rid of the attack a little bit. Especially because of the hat. Because I already had the other one. So, the main takeaway. Good sample selection. Messing around with different sounds. Keeping it simple. Keeping it not too clean. It can be a little bit dirty. I think that sounds cool. And that's how I make music. Yeah, and then there's also like just this standard stuff. Don't overthink everything. You know, you're gonna have a build-up after this. How do you get into a build-up like this? Well, you add a... This type of stuff, you have some build-up drums. Also here, the drum loop kind of remains, which is cool. Gives the track this, like, movement. Yeah, let's fucking go. We have a bass line, which is just bounced out. You know, just this stuff. Keeping it rolling, keeping it going. Super simple stuff. You can also hear that there is some like short reverb on all of this. So super simple stuff. And then in the second drop, we are even adding some stuff. These vocals here, I think this is a pretty cool thing. So putting all these vocals in there, and I basically made them, I think, with a pitch. Yeah, with a vocal transformer. Probably set to robotize. Yes. So a vocal transformer set to robotize basically means that now whatever input you give it, it's going to output this pitch. And so then when you put some crush on that and a very narrow EQ like this, very narrow bandpass, and Valhalla room and an LFO tool and whatever the hell it is. I mean, the LFO tool is on this one. So on the bus for all of these vocals together. But when you do all of these things, you know, you can now start to formulate chords, and that's what I did. So this first chord is C. Then here we have a and then F, it's a higher F, I think. And then I think this is probably D, right? D, yes, there we go. And so together that sounds like this. Without the LFO tool. Cool effect, isn't it? And then the cool thing with these very simple chords is that you can just literally move the bass note and it's gonna make sense. So now this is going down to a B flat or A sharp, as you may have imagined. Sounds good. Yeah, and then this is a little break. That's why I cut it off here. Literally just, again, a volume automation because we have the vocal again. So I think this track is super simple. I had to make some change, and the change was obviously to give it that evolution from this hyper sunny thing to this more sort of, we're kind of getting to the evening vibe, into the club. So the first chord progression was like B flat, C, D minor, F, you know, which is like 6-7-1-3 in minor chord progression. And this one is just a 1-6 and then back to 1. back to 6 chord progression in minor, and you know what it does emotionally, you know, because you can hear it and you have a heart, so you feel what it does emotionally. And so this is a very simple little chord switch up. This time we have all three bass layers from the get-go, so to say. Now for more of the clubby feeling here. Hey. Yeah, some automations here and there for whatever the hell, cutoff and everything. Yeah, nice, and then dun-dun-dun. Again, drums remain precisely the same. Nothing special. All the same stuff. We have the vocal here as well, again, and this stuff again. So, a lot of just copied stuff from the first drop. And we don't have the answer here, which I think, in the context of the whole track, is really cool. Cool progression, so... And there are the chords. Yeah. Yeah, again, so chords. So this time the ESE layer is just opened all the way, all the time. So I basically got rid of the automation here. Also got rid of the automation in the second part of the first drop. I mean, this is just the progression of the track, you know. Now to go to the outro. Drums roll. Vocal cuts back. Bassline still going. And then real outro. Hey, yeah, man. Hyper simple. Like these kinds of things, man. This sounds so cool. This is like a, this is a proper thing like for the clubs. But you know how simple it is to make this? This is super simple. This is three layers. As said, you can get the sounds in the description. Also the Serum preset if you want to. This is super simple to make. And it's so effective. A kick from Splice. This time even just the kick without the top one, you know? Then a little like combination of sounds, this type of stuff. Together with the claps. Works, just works. It's also very simple to mix this down because we have like, what, 6 or 7 layers that are active. It's way easier to mix this type of stuff down than like a huge project of like 400 layers, which also I have done many times, and I can just tell you it's way easier to mix it down when you have an oversight over everything and when there isn't a lot of stuff going on. It's not like there's nothing going on here, but it's not a lot of stuff. But also, yeah, I also wanted to very quickly show you something that's pretty cool, I think. I made 3 different types of layers here for 3 different types of chords. So one is just this minor chord. So this is now a Serum preset for a minor chord, which is also going to be in the description, in the link, downloadable from the link in the description in the pack that's linked to that. So I think that's super cool. Major chord. And then this super beautiful major chord. I think that's really cool. When you lay that on top of the bass sounds here, gives it a cool little like chordal context type of thing. Bit of resonance as well. I like it. Isn't that cool? I think that sounds dope. Just a little extra something, just a little bit. Yeah. I think there are some cool aspects of this track, and for me they are first of all the arrangement, because it's not your typical arrangement, because we have 8 bars of an intro, and that's kind of enough even for the track. It doesn't have to have more. So that's one thing that I really like about this. I think the other thing is that it's actually very simple. We have one vocal, we kind of recontextualize the vocal. First we have this very like summer type feeling here. We also have this like forest ambience, by the way, here. It's running through the first drop, right? And then we don't have that anymore in the second drop because we recontextualize the vocal. It feels like the sun is kind of setting, you know? I tend to now go in and like get a lot of cool like stabs and make a lot of moments where it goes like out of the flow. And back into it. For what? For what? This is completely keeping it simple, and it makes the most tense in this kind of scenario. So what is going on here exactly for the mastering? It's a glue compressor, and this is for me the best mastering compressor. I haven't even paid for this, so this is a trial version still. The thing is, with this, it still works. So these are the settings. I always keep the attack at 3 milliseconds and the release at 0.1. This is something that I learned from Rootlies back in the day, and I'm never changing this. This is the best thing for any type of EDM. Even if you're making like dubstep or you're making drum and bass, keep these ones the way they are, ratio at 4. All of this stuff here you don't want to care about. What you do want to care about is the threshold. You should reduce it to a place where it kind of gets rid of like 2 to 3 dB. So it's now reducing like maybe 2 or 3 decibels. That's precisely right. And then obviously makeup gain, you can always just do that later, or you do it here, doesn't matter. Yeah, then I have a match EQ. This is very important for me. I basically let Logic listen to the EQ curve of my song. And then you get like a profile of this. And the reference for this is plain white noise. This is very easy to do in Logic. You can just click plus and you can create a utility test oscillator. And then you set that to white noise and then you just let that play. And you take that as a reference and then you click on match on the EQ curve. And always make sure that the smoothing here is on 0, because otherwise you don't get all this very useful and very nice information here. Because if you do this, then all of that gets lost and you just get a more general EQ curve. But this is actually the kind of stuff that you want. So then you can apply this. In this case, 24% is even quite generous. I wouldn't even do it that much. I would probably fix the mix if I had to do it a lot. And this way you can push the sound of your track to be more balanced, because white noise is by definition a balanced sound. And so Logic has a match EQ built into it. I don't know about other DAWs. I think the new FL versions, and Ableton definitely has it, I think. But yeah, whatever. I have a Pro Q3, just some mid-side EQing. You can see that I'm taking out some of the mid signal here in the top end and I'm boosting it on the sides. Why? Because if you make the highs more side heavy, then without actually, and this is something that I learned from Mo Falk, without actually adding anything with regards to like real amplitude, so you're not even adding volume, without adding volume you can still get a more powerful feeling out of your track. So I can demonstrate that, and you have to listen pretty closely now. I'm gonna deactivate it. So this is without. I'm breathing, I'm still alive. With. I'm breathing, I'm still alive. Subtle change. It probably doesn't even make much of a difference if you don't know about it, but whatever. Who really cares? Yeah, there's an echo boat. This is what's creating this like strange echoey type of effect towards the second drop. So if I were to show you what it sounds like if I completely overdo it, it's like this. So this is a great plugin, Echo Boat. I paid for this. You should probably do so. It's an amazing plugin. Has a lot of great, great presets as well. So Echo Boat, great thing. And also a little gain automation. Probably shouldn't have done it like -3 or something, but you know. Just in this case, it was making sense for me because I really wanted to take back the energy there a little bit, so that the second drop hit a little bit harder. So that's something that you can do. Pro MB, so it's just a multiband compression for the whole track. Also drawing a little bit of a curve here, because I felt like there was something missing. So especially in like the high mids and highs, you kind of hear it, you know. And then we have two limiters. Why two limiters, Vincent? What are you doing? One of them, as you may be able to see, is a modern style, and the other one is an aggressive style. And this is actually something that I always do, and I figured this out. Because if you push a modern style limiter really hard and then put an aggressive style afterwards, you can see that the aggressive limiter sometimes catches some of the peaks that come through from the modern style limiter. You don't have to do it this way. I actually like doing it this way because I find you can push your songs way harder without stuff audibly distorting. So this is something that's just trial and error based knowledge. And then obviously to measure the loudness of this, let's measure it and let's see what we got here. And then let's also look at this in the Schultz Audio Megascope. Let's go. I'm still alive. And so for a track like this, having like -5.5 is even like, it's pretty loud. But DJs are gonna play this, so don't at me for trying to win the loudness war in this case, man. Oh, what are you talking about, loudness war? This is not how people consume music. Yes, if DJs are playing it, you want to win the loudness war. I don't care what your argument against pushing your song to the loudest it can be is. Psychologically or psychoacoustically, you could say, loud equals better. And so if I can push a song louder without it distorting, without it sounding too overcompressed or whatever, I will do it. So let's say if I didn't push the limiter like +8.5 but only +5, so then this would be the track. This would be what DJs see on their decks. -7.5, yeah, let's push a little bit more. Even this. Drums hitting the ceiling, getting a little bit of a good squash, the bass line looking good. It's all loud, it's all clear, it's all transparent sounding. That's what you want. And the loudness units are saying -5, that's good. If it's clean and loud and punchy and it's -5, that's perfect. It's better than clean, loud and punchy and -8. Clean, loud and punchy and -5. So thanks for watching this video. I hope you learned something. As said, a link to a pack full of sounds from this track will be in the description. So if you're interested in the kick sounds and the loops and the serum presets and whatever it is, go to the description. You can find it there. I would say have a nice day and see you in the next one. Bye-bye.